good afternoon, or good morning, good evening, whatever time zone you happen to be in. Welcome to the stream. My name is Carl Gold, and today I'm with you on Manning Publications stream. I'm the author of a book called Fighting Churn with Data, Science and Strategy for Keeping Your Customers. So, without further ado, I'm going to dive in and give a background on Fighting Churn with Data, Science and Strategy for Keeping Your Customers. So, to start out with, for those who aren't in this area, we want to answer, what is churn? What is churn? Why do we fight it? Churn is customers or users quitting your service. And so churn is an important issue for any product or service with repeat users or customers where you want to get recurring revenue. And that can include paid subscription products, ad-supported products, and also products with in-app purchases. Now, in-app purchases are of special interest today because we're going to look at a case study. A churn fighting case of a company that is an in-app purchase system. It's an ebook website. We'll see more about the ebook website in a couple of minutes. The origin of the term churn is from what's called the churn rate. And the churn rate means the percent of your customers that drop out or quit in a given time period. Typically, you measure churn over 1 month for a consumer product, and you might use a year to measure churn for a business product because the contracts are usually longer. So churn originated with the term the churn rate, but nowadays churn is also a verb. You can say the customer churned, or you can even say I'm churning from Netflix because I watched the last season of Peaky Blinders and there's nothing left good to watch. So you can say, I'm churning, if you're in the business. Churn is also a noun, and if you're in the business, you say things like, make a report of last quarter's churns, or let me see the churn report, or even like, that customer is a churn, you know, they canceled last week. So we hear the term churn a lot in the subscription economy, in the business that I'm in. And now you know about churn too. So what is fighting churn with data? It's the book that I wrote, and it's based on my experience as a data scientist, as the, really the chief data scientist at a company called Zuora. What is Zuora? Well, Zuora is a software platform that subscription businesses use to run their companies. We have a lot of customers that you've probably heard of, from Avalara to Zoom. Yes, Zoom is one of our customers at Zuora. And so Zuora is a software platform that these businesses use to run their business. And it handles things like defining what a subscription even means for your company, the different types of subscriptions you might offer, and then it includes billing. So once you've got your customers on subscription, you want to bill them every month or year or week or whatever, you know, whatever it is you do. And for more advanced companies, more mature companies, we also do things like accounting, finance, revenue recognition. So it's a back end for lots of companies to offer you subscriptions. But you probably never heard of Zuora because, you know, we're kind of hiding in the back. So that's what churn is. That's what fighting churn with data is. And that's what Zuora is. So let's dive into the rest of the stream. Let's talk about what you actually do about churn. So churn is bad because no one wants to lose their customers, but how do you stop it? Well, there's a few ways to stop churn, and I like to say that the best way to stop churn is just have a great product, because if you have a great product, you know, your customers will stay. But you can use your data to figure out the features and content that your customers really love. You can also use data to market, or rather remarket yourself to your existing customers. And this usually takes the form of targeted engagement campaigns. And that means things like, you know, emails or, you know, messages that highlight the best features and content on your system. And again, you can use your data to figure out what are the best features and particularly which customers need to hear about them, because you don't want to spam people telling them about stuff they already know. So you use your data to figure out which customers need to know about which features and get the message to them. That way the messages are really valuable. So also for fighting churn, you might use customer success and support. Customer success, those are the people who you call up when you're having a problem on a product. Or rather, that's customer support. Support is the people you call up. Customer success are the people who are supposed to call you up, and they use data to figure out what customers need help on a product. And so that's where the customer success team is going to be calling you for. All right, last area to note is sales and pricing. And in this area, you want to really come up with a pricing plan so that everyone gets value, but you're not giving people discounts. A lot of people think that fighting churn is about giving out discounts, but actually giving out discounts is the worst way to fight churn, because it actually undermines your pricing over time once everyone can learn that in order to get a discount, they just call up and threaten to churn. That's basically what happened with the cable companies. They gave out discounts to fight churn, and now everyone knows you just call up, threaten to cancel, and you'll get a discount. So by using your data, you can come up with a pricing plan where customers get value without discounting. So these are the ways that most companies fight churn with data. And what about the data? Let's look at some data. So I'm already set with the query I need, which is to look at the event table. So the data for most of these churn fighting cases consists of events. Let's look at some events right here. I got this by doing select star from the ebook site event table. And this shows you actually what events are like for practically any product where you're fighting churn with data. Your event table lists what individual customers, users, or accounts are doing at particular times. So the first column in your event table is going to be your account ID, because every event has to be tied to an individual account that you can track. The next column in the event table is the time. Every event has to be at a single point in time, so that's a timestamp. And then importantly, your events have types. So this is an ebook reading website, so the events all have to do with things about the books. So you've got events for like reading your own book, a book that you own, something about product table of contents. There's highlighting, so you can like, you know, create highlights in your books. That's like another event. And these events that have to do with book reading, in this case, they all also have a product ID. So I can individually identify what product the people on the ebook website are reading. There's also an additional data column on the ebook website. We're not going to look at that too much today. But this is actually the data that you're generally working with in almost any churn fighting case. You have a table or data warehouse of events, which are all time-stamped things that happen to your customers. And the challenge is to take that raw data and turn it into something useful for fighting churn. So that's our first look at the data. We're going to be looking at some more data soon. Here's an example of what the data looks like over time. And this is an event versus time check on the data. It's kind of a quality assurance check. And this gives you more of a big picture of what the data look like. This one here on the left is the reading owned book events. That's when people are, reading books on the website. And you can see that the use really goes in weekly cycles. So this is a product that people are mostly using during the week to read their books. Seems to be less use on the weekend. And also importantly, when I look at data like this, there's no gaps or there's no extreme outliers. That's something else that I'm checking for when I look at these kinds of plots. This one on the right is the time count plot of the reading open chapter. Now, an open chapter is actually the free chapter. So on this ebook website, every book has one free chapter, or most books have one free chapter. And reading open chapter is the event that you have when you're reading an open chapter. Now, I want to point out that these plots were produced with code from the book, Fighting Churn with Data. All the code from the book is free, and you can get it at GitHub, open source. The book is really kind of like a guidebook to the code. So if you're good at coding, you're welcome to use the code without the book. But anyway, I'm not going to take the time to look at this listing. I think you can imagine this listing is a simple aggregation over time. Not super interesting. Maybe we'll look at another one in a minute. But this is the way we look at the events and just see, you know, what's in the data before we go on further with our analysis. This is another type of summary of the event data. This is chapter 3, listing 11. Again, the code's on GitHub. And this shows the events per account per month, which is a good way to summarize the frequency of the different events. Because when you put it in events per account per month, it's intuitive, you know, how frequent is this event for customers. You can actually see that most of these events are not actually that frequent at the customer level. The event reading own book, where you're, you know, reading a book on the ebook website live, that has more than average of one event per month. Ebook downloads average about a half an event per customer per month. And then these other events get even more and more rare. There's things like reading free preview, highlight created. Those happen for some accounts every month, but for many accounts, not at all. And then you have even more rare events going down to, let's see, the least common event is the comments created event. And that's very rare. Most events are not making comments. I mean, most customers are not making comments, but hey, that's fine. You know, customers don't have to use every feature in your product for your product to be a success. So this is also an important way to get a look at your events when you do this kind of analysis, and it directs your attention at the most important events or the most significant events, simply because, you know, these rare events that are, you know, over on the right, they might be interesting, but when they're that rare, they're probably not going to help you with fighting churn, just because not that many customers are having those kinds of events. So these last two bits show you ways to check your event data and just know what's in your event data. And how to do this type of analysis of your events is all covered in the book. I'm not going to go into it today. Right now, I just want to give you an overview of like what's in the ebook website, so you know. All right. Now let's step back a little bit and talk about fighting churn again, now that you got a little sense of the data. Now, why is churn hard to fight? You know, why is this all a thing? You know, what's the big deal here? Well, there's a few reasons churn is hard to fight. First, churn is hard to predict, even if you're using data science and machine learning. And it's because your information about your customers is limited. You don't really know everything that you want to about your customers from these simple events you're collecting. And also, there's subjectivity. You'll never really know what your customers think of your product. I mean, so maybe if you do a survey, you'll get some customers' opinions, but you know, most customers, you're not really gonna know what they think. That also makes it hard to predict churn. And then for churn, you know, you've got a random timing element. Like, and you've probably experienced this with the last time you churned from some service like Netflix or Hulu, you probably weren't watching anything for a while. And you were thinking, oh man, I gotta cancel that Netflix subscription. I haven't watched anything for 6 weeks. And then another month goes by, you don't find the time. And you're like, oh man, I gotta cancel that Netflix subscription. You know, time goes by, and then finally you'll find time to churn, no doubt. But if there was like someone trying to predict when you were going to churn, they would have a very hard time predicting exactly when you would find the time to hit that cancel button, even though it may be obvious that there's a churn coming, because if you haven't watched anything for so long, you know, it's, you know, kind of a given. Anyway, so churn is hard to predict, even with data science. But worse than being hard to predict, churn is hard to present, because these customers already know your products. You know, you can't fool them with marketing and promises. So you actually have to deliver more value to the customers. That's why the ways that you fight churn focus on improving the product or making sure that all the customers, you know about the good features. So that way you can get more value to the customers. So there's no silver bullets to stop churn. I've heard that. Oh, I need a few silver bullets to stop churn. Well, guess what? Bad news. There are no silver bullets to stop churn. You actually have to do the work to improve your product, to reduce churn in a meaningful way. Now, lastly, churn is hard to fight because it's a multi-team effort. Typically, you have multiple divisions or departments responsible for churn. Like I mentioned before, you're going to have the product creators, the marketers, and then like customer success and support, your sales team. So everyone's going to have something to do for churn, but they're all going to have different tools and methods. They're going to have communication issues, and there's probably also going to be some finger pointing and blame game about, you know, whose responsibility is it to stop what kinds of churn. So these are all challenges that make churn hard to fight, and it's important to understand these to get the motivation for the techniques that I take in the book. So how can data help here? Now, first thing you're probably thinking, since this is about data science, is can we use AI for fighting churn? Now, the truth is AI is not much help at reducing churn, even though you can predict churn. I mean, I said a minute ago, you can't predict churn that well, but you can predict churn to some degree. But AI is not that much help at reducing churn because there's no one-size-fits-all way to reduce churn. You have these different types of interventions, and each intervention has, you know, different characteristics, different customers you want to target it to. So you need data to target and design your interventions. But you don't necessarily need AI or machine learning per se for most of these use cases. So the churn fighters need insights and information, you know, from you, but there's limited uses just for a standalone AI system that predicts churn. So data drive can be used to drive those interventions that we were talking about, product improvements, engagement campaigns, customer success and support. But interventions are going to be targeted using what we call customer metrics. Now, a customer metric is like a summary of the events for one customer. So, for example, on the ebook website, we have events that represent reading a book. And the count of books read per month would be an example of a metric. That's pretty much the most basic metric, you know, you can come up with. How much are people doing of things within the recent past? You might measure it over a month, or you'll see. For the ebook churn case, I actually ended up measuring the events over a quarter. We'll get to that in just a minute. So example of a metric is a count of books per month, and the focus of fighting churn with data is actually on these metrics. What metrics do you choose, and how do you create the metrics from the raw data? And then usually when you've created a good set of metrics, as you'll see, you can turn those over to the churn fighters, the churn fighting team at your organization, and they'll usually know what to do with them. So this is also known as feature engineering. If you're a data scientist, I'm talking about creating the measurements from your raw data. Data scientists typically call that feature engineering. Now, personally, I don't like to use the term feature engineering a lot because I work at a software company, and at a software company, you've got software engineers and software features. And if you start talking about feature engineering, you'll generally get a lot of people confused because they're going to be like, hey, I thought you were the data scientist team. Why are you engineering features? I thought the software engineering team was going to make the features, right? The product features is what they're talking about. So usually in my day job, I don't talk about feature engineering. I only do that with other data scientists. So I mostly in the book, I talk about you want to make great customer metrics, you know, and great customer metrics are going to help the churn fighters do their job. So let's talk a little bit more about this feature engineering and creation of metrics. That's the next section. First, let's just talk very briefly at a high level about a metric, and then we'll look at some code. So this is the process that we use for calculating metrics. And interestingly, if you haven't seen this type of approach before, it's all done in the database. So you have your events, which I already showed you, in a table, and then you actually use SQL aggregations over customers and time to turn the events into metrics, and you pretty much put these metrics right back into your data warehouse or database. Now, the events, as we mentioned, are generally big data, and they're usually underutilized and kind of messy. They might have duplicates and errors. Your metrics are usually more like medium data, because you don't calculate the as many metrics as you have events. Like one metric can summarize all the events for one account in a month or a week or a quarter or whatever you've got. So this is the way we calculate the metrics. I think that now I'll actually go look at some code for this. We'll take a look at chapter 3, listing 3 from my book, just to show you what I mean by an aggregation over customers and time. It's actually quite simple if you know SQL. We're just gonna drop into PyCharm here, take a look at some code. So this is from the GitHub repo for my book. This is chapter 3, listing 3, and you can see it's a insert statement. That's what we've got here. So it's an insert select statement, which means we're gonna run this select and push it back into the database. So the first part of the SQL is actually to generate a sequence of dates, because like I mentioned, the metrics summarize over customers and time. So you can calculate multiple metric measurements at one time by using a date series selection like this. So that's how we generate a series of dates, and then the metric selection shown here is actually a simple aggregation. If you're familiar with SQL aggregations, we're doing a count star on the events where the type is given by, well, there's one type, and this SQL is actually showing it with a bind variable, because all the code in the Fighting Churn with Data repo is designed to be used on any system with any type of events. So we plug in the event to measure using a bind variable in the SQL. And by running this SQL repeatedly for different events, we'll get all the metrics that we need to measure our customers. Now, I'm not going to run this SQL right now because I've already done that for this ebook website case. In fact, if you go back and watch one of my earlier streams, you can watch me, you know, creating those metrics. Right now, let's just take a look at some of the summary of the metrics. Go back to the slide deck here. And this is a summary of the result of calculating these metrics. And this is listing 5.2, that's chapter 5, listing 2. Again, you can get it on my GitHub repo. So this summarizes the results for calculating the 10 or so metrics shown here. The first column in the summary is the percentage of accounts that have a non-zero value on the metric. And you can see that some of the events, the most common, all customers have. So all customers have read some books in the last 90 days. That's what the 90D means here. So I calculated these events using a 90-day window. I didn't really mention that, but let's go quickly look at the code. So that's, in this case, I've got it hard-coded to 90 days. So that's why the counts are all for 90-day events. So back to the summary, you can see that the average account has read around 3.5 books in the last 90 days, and all accounts have read some books. Same for the total events. The average account has had 23 events in the last 90 days, and all accounts have had some events. The next most common event is actually ebook download. So a lot of people read their books on the ebook website. Other people download their books. So 54% of the accounts have downloaded a book in the last 90 days, and the average number of downloads is 4.4. So a metric summary like this is a great way to check your metrics after you've calculated them and see what actually happens. Because, see, this percent of customers that have the metric and the average value of those for customers that do have it are very informative. It's kind of more informative than what we looked at before, which was just the number of events per account per month. But those averages kind of blended together those who did the action and those who didn't do it at all. So you can see here that for the customers who actually performed the action, the average values are somewhat higher. So a summary like this is a great way to check your metrics after you've calculated them and see, did it all work out, and what happened. So some metrics show that the events are rare. Only 3% of accounts have made a highlight, and only 18% of accounts have read, you know, an open chapter. And again, the open chapter are the free chapters that they give out on the ebook website. So, yes, this is a good way to summarize all your metrics after you made them. But now, what else are we going to do with these metrics? The really important thing is to look at the relationship between metrics and repurchases, and that's what I'm demonstrating here. This is one of the most important techniques from the book, and we'll go into this code in a minute. We can run one of these metric cohorts just to see what the code looks like. But the metric cohort is where you group the customers by values of the metric. You might have heard of cohort analysis, where you group customers by the date where they sign up, and then you look at who churns out over time. That's the most common kind of cohort analysis outside of my book. But in my book, I teach this technique, which is metric cohorts. So you calculate metrics for all your customers, and then you group them together based on what their value is on the metric. So then you make this plot where, that was what I already said, you group them by the metric. You put the cohort purchase rate on the y-axis. So that's what we're looking here. So this cohort, the bottom cohort, has the lowest purchase rate, and these higher cohorts have higher purchase rates. The average of the value in the metric is on the x-axis. So now you can hopefully see everything we're looking at here. The most active cohort on the ebook website has more than 100 events in the last 90 days on average, and they have a much higher purchase rate for new books in the next 90 days. The lowest cohort has only maybe one or a few events in the last 90 days, and they have the lowest purchase rate. Now, why do I present the data like this? Because it's easy to understand and act on. In comparison to something like a regression, where, you know, if you're a data scientist or statistician, you might do a regression or, you know, use some statistics to get the same information. But normal humans find these cohort plots very interpretable. Now, I want to mention one thing, that I'm not actually showing you the cohort purchase rate. So the real numbers are missing here, and that's to protect the confidentiality of the ebook website. They're letting me use their data and show it to you on this stream, but they don't want to tell you everything about their business. You know, this is sensitive information. So throughout this stream and throughout these analyses, I'm not going to be showing you the true purchase rate, but the data is scaled, so the zero is at the bottom of the plot, and that means you can judge the relative purchase rate. So the lowest cohort to the highest cohort, you've got more than twice the rate of purchases in the top cohorts. And when I said this is easy to understand and act on, partly that's because you can look and see things like, well, what's a healthy level for the customer? A healthy level for the customer is around 20 events, because at that level, you've gotten most of the benefit, and going from 20 to 120 events doesn't actually increase the purchase rate as much as just going from 1 to 20 events. So it's very easy for people to understand and act on. Now, how do I make these cohort plots? Let's actually go and look at some code, and I'll even run it for you. We can make one live right now, even though I've already made this. You know, it's fun just to look. Now we'll actually look at some Python. So I have a wrapper program that I use to run the listings on the stream. It's called my Run Ebook Site Listing program. Very creative, right? And let's see. We want to make a cohort plot. So I'm going to go up. Look for my cohort. Here's my cohort plot function. It's just a loop over metrics, and I call the cohort plot listing, which is from the book. That's listing 5.1 in the book. So I'm going to put a breakpoint here at the cohort plot function, and we'll go into it. I have, like I mentioned, there's a wrapper program that's going to ask me what step I'm trying to run in just a moment. Let's see. I want cohort plots. That's number 7. I'm just going to tell it run step 7. Should hit my breakpoint here. All right, so now we'll go into and look at the cohort plot generation. You can see here the metric we're running for is number of books read 90D, which means number of books read in the last 90 days. So let's step into this function, and I'll show you guys how we calculate the cohort plots. It's actually very easy when you use pandas and matplotlib. In this case, I've already saved a data set of the metrics and the purchase data. I didn't go into how I create the data set in this stream. It's actually in one of my older streams. Maybe I'll review it again in a future stream. But for right now, I've got a data set. Actually, let's take a look at the data set. So this is the data set of purchase data. We can easily take a look at it in PyCharm by viewing it as a data frame. So this gobbledygook on the left is actually my index, and it's a combination of the account ID and the date when I measured the metrics. The next column is the indicator variable for whether or not this customer made another purchase in the next 90 days. So that's how I'm doing the analysis. I look at all the metrics in the last 90 days, and then the outcome I analyze is who made a purchase in the next 90 days. So then after the index and the purchase outcome are all of the metrics. So here's the metric for reading own book 90 days, then the metric for ebook download. So every metric has a column. And this is the standard, you know, format for data sets in data science. Each metric, each row is one observation with an outcome, and then each column is one explanatory variable or independent variable. All right, so there's the data set. Let's go back to the cohort plot code. So we open the data set, and then we actually use the qcut function shown here to calculate the cohorts. Qcut stands for quantized discretization. The mouthful, but basically it does the cohort formation, where it takes, you tell it how many cohorts you want, and then it's going to form the groups, a given number of groups based on that. And so typically you would say 10 cohorts and get deciles. Now the groups is actually going to be a series of indicators showing for each row of the data which cohort they were in. Then we use the pandas group by functions to calculate the mean metric value in the cohort, and also the cohort purchases is just the mean of the purchase indicator. So these two lines actually calculate what we really want to plot, and then I put them into another data frame. Now if we look at this data frame, we've basically got all the data for the cohort plot at this point. You've got the number of books read and the purchase rate, you know, in the other column. And all that's left now is to plot it. And so for that, we just go to matplotlib, where it's easy to plot an entire data frame. So this is how we make the cohort plots.